I'd like to call your attention to the book of Colossians. The book of Colossians, chapter number 1 and verse 3. And we're going to read down from verse number 3 to verse number 14. Beginning in verse number 3, we give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you. Since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love which you have to all the saints. For the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof ye heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel, which is come unto you as it is in all the world, and bringeth forth fruit, and it doth also in you since the day ye heard of it, and knew the grace of God in truth. As ye have also learned of Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, who is for you a faithful minister of Christ, who also declared unto us your love in the Spirit. For this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that you might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might, according to his glorious power, unto all patience and long suffering with joyfulness, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom, verse 14, we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Now, when we come to the book of Colossians, we find that we are studying a passage out of one of the prison epistles that the Apostle Paul has written. We understand that Ephesians, Colossians, Philippians, and Philemon are known as the prison epistles. And so here the Apostle Paul is writing to a group of believers whom he never met. And so we find that in this passage, the Apostle Paul is being revealed from the depths of his heart toward new believers in Christ. And I want to take some time to remind us that Paul was always concerned for the souls of those he continued to pray for. Paul's heart was always for those whom he felt as if they were his spiritual children. And I believe that the Apostle Paul had such a drive and such an interest in seeing the Gentiles saved, because we learn in Romans chapter 10 that he had such a desire to see his own countrymen saved. And so this heart of Paul is being revealed to us right here in this first chapter of the book of Colossians. Let me just point out to us that Paul declared who they were in Christ. Paul has made this declaration of who they were in Christ. The Bible says, Paul writing in verse 3, we give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus. Isn't it amazing that the Apostle Paul is declaring who they were in Christ? And the reason that they could even be saved was because of being in Christ. He talks about in verse 14, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sin. We understand that salvation is of the Lord. And Paul is declaring who they are in Christ. And he says, here's what I've heard about you. What was it that Paul heard about them? Well, he heard about their faith. He heard about how that they had faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so he's declared who they are in Christ. And Paul says, I heard about you. I have heard about them. And then not only what Paul heard about them, but what Paul had for them. What was it that Paul had to say to them? He had a word of thanks, didn't he? He had a word of thanks for the faith that they had in the Lord Jesus Christ. And he had a word of thanks for Epaphras, this faithful servant, this fellow servant that Paul had in the ministry and his ministry in their lives. And so Paul had thanks. He gave thanks to God on their behalf. And Paul was very thankful for this great report that he had heard about them. And he had this great report from Epaphras, just as John got a great report of Gaius over in 3 John. How that we hear, don't we? We get word a lot of times about fellow believers. And it's amazing raising 4 children that there were times where I would get called to the side by a teacher or maybe someone at the church or maybe a family member. They'd say, "If you got a minute, I'd like to tell you something about your son. I got something I need to tell you about your daughter." And so, of course, as a father, you would cringe because you didn't know what the news might be. But oh, wasn't it great when you got some good news about your children? And wasn't it great when you got some good news and it wasn't bad news? They hadn't done anything wrong, but yet they had done something right. And so this is what Paul is saying. He's saying to them that you have been talked about, but you haven't been talked about in the negative sense, but you've been talked about in the positive sense. And so we think about Paul and his declaration of who they were in Christ. He talked about what he had heard of them, and he talked about what he had for them. He was so thankful for the testimony of their faith. But then what Paul hungered for them. I think this is very interesting as we move forward from Paul's declaration of who they were in Christ. His hunger for them moves us to the thought of Paul's desire of who they could be in Christ. You see, Paul knew who they were in Christ. You understand that the Apostle Paul is writing to believers. He is writing to the church. I think a lot of times we fail when we think that if someone is immature or if someone is in sin, well, they must not be saved. We forget that we begin. Simon Peter talked about in 1 Peter 2, he talked about being babes as newborn babes. Desire the sincere miracle of the word that you may grow thereby. He said in chapter 1 of 1 Peter, chapter 1 and verse 23, that we've been redeemed, not of corruptible things, but of the incorruptible word of God which liveth and abideth forever. And so Paul is writing to believers here, and Paul is declaring who they are, not who they won't ever be in Christ, but who they are right then in Christ. He is talking about the present. But then he goes on, he moves on and reveals his hunger for them. He is grateful, he is thankful that they've been saved, but it's once they have become in Christ, there's more to being in Christ than just saying, "Hey, I'm saved." Now they must grow in the grace and in the knowledge of the Lord. And so Paul hungered for them. He had a great hunger in his heart for them to go on. So he declared who they were in the faith. But now Paul's desire is revealed of who they could be in Christ and in their faith. Notice in verse 9, he said, "For this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you." Now see, Paul is thanking God for their faith, but Paul is praying to God for their growth. Paul is thanking God for their faith in Christ, but he is now praying to God that they would grow in Christ. Isn't that the life of all believers? Isn't that the life of all of us in the physical sense? We are born into this world as a babe in Christ, but we must grow thereby. We must grow into the maturity, into the adulthood. And Paul is saying this is the same in the spiritual sense. I've heard of who you are in Christ, but now I want you to go into Christ further. I want you to walk with Christ. He says in verse number 9, he reminds them that he wants them to be wise in the will of God. He wants them to be wise in the will of God. Now this is interesting because he says that he desired that they might be filled with the knowledge That's simply understanding, that they would have an understanding. And he says that they would be filled with this knowledge of his will. And in verse 9, he said, in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. Well, spiritual understanding is just divine understanding. It's knowing what the will of the Lord is. And so when we think about this, Paul had a desire of who they could be in Christ. And one thing he desired was, and one thing that he prayed for was that they would be wise to the will of God. Well, that would help us all if we had some wisdom when it came to what the will of God is for our own life. But he then says in verse 10, not only that he wanted them to be wise in the will of God and have this this wisdom concerning the will of God, but he then said that he wanted them to walk in the worth of God. Notice what he said, that we might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing. Now, this is interesting because Paul is writing and he says in Ephesians 4 and 1, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called. And we understand that Paul has written about this walking worthy, and how that Paul is talking about this worthiness of our life, not to be saved, but because we are saved. Now that we are saved, what do we do? Paul is praying that they would be wise in the will of God, but that they would walk worthy toward God, into all pleasing, he said, that what we do and how we live what would please the Lord, that it would be worthy. It's interesting that the word worthy is a word that literally means to be suitable, that it would suit God, that it would please God, that we would have such a walk that it would be worthy and pleasing unto the Lord. Do you remember that Paul tells Timothy, he told Timothy, he said, I tell you what I want you to do. I want you to be a soldier. But Paul emphasizes something. He said, I want you to be a good soldier. Now, why did he do that? Why did Paul say to Timothy, I want you to be a good soldier? Well, I'll tell you why. Because anybody can be a soldier. Anybody can be a soldier. But in being a soldier, you can be a good soldier or a bad soldier. Paul didn't just say, hey, I just want you to get in this battle. I want you to get in this war. I want you to get in this ministry. He said, no, no. He said, I want you to be a good soldier. Wonder why Paul is saying right here, I don't want you just to walk with the Lord, but I want you to walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing. You see, a lot of people get this confused. They think that they have to walk worthy to get saved. But there's nothing that we could do before Christ is in us and we are in Christ that could bring about any worth that would save us, because within us we are hopelessly lost and condemned to hell. But yet we find that through Christ Jesus, we now are able, because of the power of the Holy Ghost that lives within us, we are able to walk in this world, and our walk can be pleasing unto the Lord. That is why when we stand before the Lord and we give an account of the deeds done in our body, whether they be good or bad, and we receive the rewards that we get at that day, that's why the Bible says that they can be good or bad. And so Paul is emphasizing here how that he has a desire that they become who they could be. They're in Christ. He's declared that. You're saved, but I want you now, I want you to go on in Christ, and I want you to grow in Christ. I want you to have this wisdom and this spiritual understanding of his will, and I want you to walk worthy of his will. But isn't it amazing? In verse number 12, he goes on to say, not only does he mention being wise in his will and to walk worthy of his will, but then he says to them, I want you to have worship in his will. I want you to desire what I desire for you. That's why he's praying. He's praying to God that God would do with them and in them what God had done in his own life. He wanted his children in the faith to grow in this faith. And he wanted them to have this want, this desire for worship. Notice what he said in verse 12. Giving thanks unto the Father which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. He says to them, look in verse 3. He said, we give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you. Paul saying, now I have been given thanks, and I am the one that is giving thanks for your faith. Now what I want you to do is I want you to give thanks unto the Lord. I want you to give thanks unto the Father. This idea of giving, this word giving that is mentioned in verse number 12, it's a word that carries a deliberate action. It is a word that has an intentional effort. It is the initiating idea that we would take the initiation to give thanks. I think this is something that we must understand, that as a natural parent, and I use these natural illustrations because Paul feels in the faith that these are his children. These are his children in the faith. And so in the natural sense, isn't it amazing how we feel as parents when a child will come up to us out of the blue without any prompting, without any pushing, and they walk up to us and they give us thanks for all the things that we are doing, seen and unseen in their life. And a child just come up and said, Daddy, I just want to thank you. I just want to say to you how much I appreciate you and all that you do for me. Well, if you've raised children as I have, my oldest daughter is 30 and my youngest son is 21. I have a 29-year-old daughter and a 25-year-old son. And what I found over the years, that the further they mature in this natural sense, the older they get, and now being parents themselves, they begin to appreciate their father and their mother more after they've lived a while. Paul has lived, he has served the Lord, he has went through the trials and the tribulations, and he's saying to them, I thank God for you, but I think you need to thank God for yourselves. Notice what he said, giving thanks unto the Father, giving thanks. He is giving them some encouragement in how that they can become more like Christ now that they are in Christ. And so he said in verse 10 that ye might, and he gives them this list. He begins to list down some things, and he says, give thanks to the Father. Don't wait around on that. I was thinking as I was studying this passage of Scripture, this idea of giving thanks is something that should just be done. We are to thank God for the obvious, but we are to thank God for the daily things, the daily benefits. I understand that we are people of big minds and big things. We even say in our churches, you know, we go to church, we go to the worship service, and all of a sudden somebody gets saved, a family gets right with God, somebody comes and testifies and gives a praise to all that God has done, and all of a sudden we leave the service and somebody says, well, how'd it go down there? And I said, well, I'll tell you, God did something big. You know, God did a big thing in our church today. Well, here's the reality. That wasn't big to God. There's nothing big or little to God. It's just God being God. And so what about God just being God in our life every single day and providing all of the benefits that he does? We don't have to wait until the big rain of God falls. We can praise God as the dew. We can praise God as that blessing that comes silently, and that blessing that comes steadfastly, and that blessing that comes sweetly, that dew that falls every morning. A lot of people's waiting on God to do a big rainstorm in their life, and they forget to praise him and thank him for the very dew things that he does. He told Hosea in chapter 14, he said, I will be as the dew unto Israel. So when we think about this, Paul is encouraging them to be wise in his will. He's encouraging them to walk worthy of his will. But he's encouraging them to have a want to worship in his will. While you are saved, you are saved now. You have been born again. Give the Father thanks. And so we think about Paul. He declares who they are in Christ. You are saved. And then Paul desires who they could be in Christ. He said, now that you're saved, I want to say to you, go on. But let me close this out as we wind this thought down on thanking God for faith and praying to God for growth. Paul not only declared who they were in Christ, and Paul not only had a desire for who they could be in Christ, but Paul then had a delight of who they would be in Christ. Notice, if you will, in verse 3, we give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you. Since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love which you have in all saints, in verse 5, here we go now, for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven. Now, they're not in heaven. It's very obvious that in verse number 2, the Bible says to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ, which are where? Which are at Colossae. So they're not in heaven. They're in Colossae. But Paul said, because you got faith, that's who you are. You are saved. Notice what he said in verse number 2. He said, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ, you're saved, which are at Colossae. You are saved, but you're at Colossae. Jesus talked about that in John 17. He said, we're in the world, but we're not to be of the world. But then he prayed in John 17 in verse 15, and he said to his Father, he said, I don't pray that you'll take them out of the world. We're in Colossae, but we're in Christ. But when they got saved, God didn't take them to heaven. He left them there to be witnesses to all those around in the surrounding towns and in their town and in their lives. And that's exactly what he's done to us. And so here's what Paul is saying. He's delighted to go on and tell them not only who they are in Christ and who they can be in Christ, but then he says, here's who you will be in Christ. You will be saved eternally. Well, aren't you thankful that we may know, John said, that we have eternal life. Jesus said in John 17, I give them eternal life. Paul is writing to them in the present. He's talking about the next step of this faith, but he's also talking about their eternity. He said to them, for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven. Well, if you notice, as Paul is writing to them, he talks to them about how that they have this inheritance. He talks to them about being part of the kingdom. Paul is writing to them. He is trying to remind them that they have been translated from the kingdom of darkness, this power of darkness, verse 13, and they have been translated into the kingdom of his dear son. Now, when we think about Paul's delight of who they will be in Christ, he talked in verse 14 about this reality. This reality. He said, it's in whom? It's in whom we have redemption. Through his blood. He speaks of a person. Who is his person? It is our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It said in John 14 and 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. And Paul is just echoing that. He said, all of this is possible. All of this is made available to you because of the precious blood of Christ. And so he speaks to them of the reality. His delight in who they will be is based on the reality that all of this is possible because of Jesus Christ. But then not only the reality, in verse number 12, there's the rejoicing. He says, giving thanks unto the Father. You and I must learn from this, as he was teaching them, that we need to thank God that he so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. John 3:16. We ought to thank. He said, because of the Father, he is going to be the reason that you even got saved to start with, that he so loved you that he sent his Son to shed his precious blood, and heaven will be a reality to you because of this Father that is in heaven. And so he says, rejoice in that. Rejoice in that. And then not only did he give the reality, and not only did he give the rejoicing as he delighted in who they would be in Christ, but he talks about the residence. Notice what he said in verse 5. He said, for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven. In heaven. We get to go in heaven because we are in Christ. That's the only way, isn't it? And so Paul is excited about that. And Paul is so delighted that they now know that their home and their hope, he uses the word hope in verse 5. There is that hope, but there is that home. The hope that we have in Christ, and the hope that we have, or the home that we have in heaven. And so he deals with that. Let me close this message and conclude by reminding us the desire of every pastor, as I've pastored for 32 years, the desire is to see the children of faith get stronger in their faith. We all, and we must grow with them. We must grow. I have pastored the same church now for 25 years. I came there as a 26-year-old young preacher. And one thing I would say, that we have all grown together. Thank God for a church that will allow the pastor to grow up. And thank God for the church that will allow the man of God to preach the word of God, not only to them, but to himself and to his family. And Paul is the great example of this, isn't he? He was not selfishness in his faith. And he was not selfishness, or didn't possess selfishness in his growth. He was not trying to outfaith anybody. And he wasn't trying to outgrow anybody. He wasn't trying to say, look at me, I'm more mature. I mean, we're talking about one of the most educated men in all of the New Testament. He sat at the feet of Gamaliel. Before he was saved, he was a Hebrew of Hebrew. He was a well and learned man. But yet when he got before kings and when he got before important people, instead of impressing them with his historical knowledge and his cultural content, what Paul did was tell them about the day on the Damascus Road when God saved him and put him in the ministry and called him to take the gospel unto the Gentile. I'm just saying, Paul is not interested in Paul's advancement, but Paul was thankful for Epaphras and his ministry, and he was prayerful for the saints at Colossae to grow in the grace of God. God help us that we won't be so selfish in our maturity that we fail to bring along others that need to grow in the Lord. And so when we think about this, Paul had a love. Do you know that in this passage of Scripture, that in verse number 3, Paul says, we give thanks to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying for you always. And then he jumps into verse 4 and says, since we heard of your faith. He said, in Christ Jesus and the love which you have to all the saints for the hope. Faith, love, and hope seems to be the trail that Paul walked wherever he went. Faith, love, and hope. Faith, love, and hope. And Paul just kept on and he kept on talking about faith, love, and hope. And he had such a delight by knowing who they would be in Christ. He had such a desire of knowing who they could be in Christ. And he had such a declaration of who they were in Christ. Boy, to help this day and time, if we would ever get concerned about others and their growth in the Lord. Life has been filled with people's investments in my own personal growth. Thank God for the old men of God that invested to see that I didn't stay a babe. Paul writes to the church at Corinth in chapter 3 of 1 Corinthians, and he says, I can't feed you anything because you're still a babe in Christ. You're still on the milk. You're carnal. You still got fleshly appetites. You don't have a desire for the deeper things of God. Simon Peter said, as newborn babes, desire. And so we all come into this thing the same way. We come in as a born again Christian. We come in as a babe in Christ. And what we need is we need somebody like Paul that will help nurture us along and see that we grow and pray for our growth in the faith. And then once we begin to grow and once we have grown up, God help us that we would want to see others mature in the faith.